And we're off. Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, Pavlo. Welcome to this Daily Maverick webinar, which is sponsored by Workshop 17. So thank you so much, Workshop 17, for sponsoring this webinar. By now, I think it is widely known that businesses, especially small and medium-sized ones, have been hardest hit by the COVID-19 lockdown. As more sectors of the economy open up and public life resumes, many businesses that have managed to survive are in a recovery or restart phase. So as a business owner, are you back in business after the lockdown? Rules have been eased. What is your recovery plan for your business? We would like to hear your views. Send us your comments, questions. Please make this discussion a very interactive one. Now, we are joined by Pavlo Phitidis, who is a well-known business turnaround specialist, and he recently authored this book over here. I'm sure you can see it over here. It's called Reset, Rebuild, Reignite, Build Your Business to Thrive in a Crisis. So here it is. It's available across your leading stores. So go pick up a copy, please. Now, before, you know, this webinar started, we sort of issued a poll to gauge, you know, who would be, you know, ideally be keen on this kind of topic and webinar. So I'm going to run through some of the questions that we've asked you. We've asked you three questions. And the first is, what annual revenue generation band is your business? And gave you three options. So the first is below 5 million rand per year, between 5 million rand to 50 million rand per year, and above 50 million. And the results are overwhelmingly tilted to below 5 million rand per year. 72% of you guys are there in that category. And the second question we asked is, how do you view the current state of your business during the pandemic? And which color best describes, you know, the state of your business? And we gave you three options. First is red, high risk. The second one is amber, low risk. And the third one is green, likelihood of survival and high opportunities. And about 45.2% were in the red, high risk category, followed by 30.1% in green, meaning likelihood of survival, high opportunities, and 24.7% you know, in the low risk category. And the last question, as an entrepreneur, what is your mindset and attitude during the pandemic? And now this was quite split. About 35% will actually have an action-driven mindset. 35% again, you know, have a preservation survival mindset, and about 29.8% have a growth mindset. So with that said, Pavlo, good afternoon, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me, Ray. I'm really looking forward to this conversation. I noticed you had a whole lot of post-its in your book.
Yes, yes. We're going to have to, you know, read through this book. We're hoping for a reading from your side. So I hope you have a book on standby. Hey, Pavlo.
I do.
There we go. But first of all, Pavlo, are you surprised by the results of that poll anyway? Is it a true reflection of what's happening in the country and the profile of entrepreneurs in the country?
No, I think, look, you know, by far the majority of businesses sit in the country, sit in the smaller sphere. So if you look at our economy is shaped like a pyramid. We have very, very few large corporate entities represented in South Africa, and those numbers have fallen over a period of time. Yeah. And the way that they've responded to the crisis we face is profoundly different, right? For the simple fact that large businesses in South Africa typically have cornered the market. In many instances, they govern and dominate in their sectors. So you have the top three or the top four in any one sector. And part of that is due to how our economy emerged from the very, very early start of 1643, 1648. Yeah. It emerged always with the view to be an extractive economy to serve the colonial requirements, and the transition from an extractive economy into a creative economy was stalled for socio-political reasons, mostly political reasons. And today we are largely a extractive economy combined with a consumptive economy. So we've never had very aggressive competition in the large corporate space. And that means that over the last couple of years, these corporates have been able to build proper balance sheets. And a balance sheet's important to withstand an economic shock. We then move into the mid-tier side of the economy. And the mid-tier side, I always classify as the kind of 15, 20 to 300 million rand a year business. Yeah. Those businesses are in very interesting situations. They're certainly large enough to have built some reserves, but not substantial reserves. And those reserves would be impacted by depending what part of the economy you're in. So if you're in the social economy, you've been devastated. And that is entertainment, retail services, tourism. It's been very, very hard to adjust around that. If you didn't have any balance sheet before you went into the lockdown, you don't exist today. Sure. And then, unfortunately, largely because of economic mismanagement in the country, in my view, our economy has been regressing. There's no reason for it to regress, because with a sensible economic strategy, we should have been growing at 2 to 3% GDP compound growth per year. Yeah. But in any event, that hasn't happened. Survivalist businesses have become businesses that are really doing upwards between 5 to 7 to 8 million a year. And a lot of survivalist businesses have taken enormous pain here, because COVID, the COVID lockdown, the major brunt has been borne by SMEs, not corporate, not government, not any other institutions.
Yeah, and I mean, I read a pretty scary statistic that, you know, all the jobs created over the past decade have just been wiped out in the space of 6 to 7 months of the lockdown. So, you know, that's quite a sort of suffering for work. But Pavlo, I want to take you back to December last year. You write in your book that you run a 16-hour workday, and you know, in the middle of a lockdown, you actually wrote a book. But take us back to December, when you already had a feeling that COVID-19 was going to be global, moving from the east to the west and becoming, you know, quite prominent everywhere and every, you know, sector of the economy. Take us back to December, that moment specifically.
So, Reignite, I was very, very fortunate to, you know, as a business, we work with SMEs in South Africa, in the US, the UK, Europe, Singapore, and Hong Kong. And in the December period, the lockdown that took place in Hong Kong obviously led to trauma with my two SME clients there. And I had extensive engagements with them, and they were describing the conditions of the lockdown. And they were sharing with me a lot of the logic that premised the lockdown. And I got my first insight into how you manage pandemics. In other words, what is the well-worn path that typically was going to be followed by the remaining world? Because the pandemic was moving very clearly from east to west. Yeah. And in learning about what they were going through, I thought to myself very quickly, gosh, this is going to be a real, real devastating blow to most businesses in most countries. And given what we do, given what I do, I needed to come up with a response to it. And the response, very fortunately, was drawn from my history. You know, as a youngster, I acquired a business thinking I was clever, right? You know, when you're 21, you think that you are bulletproof, you think you... Yeah, you don't know what you don't know. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
And I acquired a business for a dollar, and unbeknownst to me, there was $420,000 of undisclosed debt, which at the time was around 5 odd million rand when I look at the rand dollar conversion. And it was a shock, an absolute shock, because I thought I had a good deal. I could never quite understand why I managed to secure the business for effectively 10 odd rand.
And the previous business owners did not tell you that information, right?
No. And on top of it, I went and I acquired the equity. So I took on all the obligations and all the debts. Yeah. But here's the thing. I promise you, I really did look at the financials. Those debts were not disclosed on the financials. They were hidden. It was effectively a fraud. And those three previous business owners, promptly after I stepped in to take the keys as such, two flew off to Australia, one flew off to the United Kingdom with their families and have never been seen again in South Africa.
Yes.
So I got horribly conned. And out of sheer necessity and out of absolute desperation and out of remarkable fear, I started to learn about how to cope with stress and cope with crises, because every single day was like that.
Yeah. I mean, that's quite remarkable, Pavlo, because you also write in the book, crises are part of life for any business owner. Change is inevitable in the mere act of doing business and existing in a dynamic world. I have to admit, Pavlo, that, with the current crisis, the world is, what the world is going through currently, it feels destructive, it feels insurmountable. And as a business owner yourself, how do you feel about the current crisis and able to embrace, the current crisis and navigate around it as well? By the way, you co-founded a company called Maverick. That's what you were referring to earlier.
Correct. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So Maverick specifically works within the SME sector, typically what we refer to as the 12, 15 to 300 odd million rand a year business. Mm. Ray, in answering your question, it depends where you are, quite honestly. The responses in the United States have been fundamentally different to that of the UK, fundamentally different to that of Singapore, and very, very different to what we experienced over here. When I look at the environment over here, initially, we had a very good response from a health perspective, but we had a terrible, terrible, terrible strategy economically, and it didn't correlate and match the requirements of the health strategy. And that's why I think eventually over a period of time, it fell apart. But the point of a crisis is this. I cannot remember more than 3 months without some sort of crisis occurring right across my business life. I certainly am not familiar with any of my clients who don't experience some shape or form of a crisis in a month. And a crisis can take many forms. It can be significant and imposed upon you, like the COVID lockdown has been for all of us.
Yeah.
Or it can be self-imposed. And very often I see self-imposed crises taking place. So a self-imposed crisis would be one wherein which you, for example, as a business say, things are working, things are fine, things are comfortable. I want to just maintain things as they are. In other words, a no growth mindset. And the way that the crisis comes about, Ray, is that you might operate in your sector or industry with a no growth mindset, saying, I'm doing fine, things are good, I don't want to complicate my life, but I can promise you, in amongst your 2, 3, 4, 5,000 competitors, 5 or 10% of them are saying, I want to grow. And in a zero growth economy like South Africa's, if your competitors are saying, I want to grow, and you opting not to grow, Ray, where are they going to get their growth? They're going to get it by eating your lunch.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's a self-imposed crisis. But other crises that take place on a daily basis, a large corporate doesn't pay me on time, or there's theft of intellectual property, or my star employee leaves, or there's a shift in the partnership. My partner and I have been working together for years and years and years. Someone has a medical issue or something else takes place, crisis. There are burst water pipes in the office and they ruin documents or equipment that wasn't properly insured. Crisis. And those crises, in many ways, I use the analogy of sailing a lot in the book. Those crises, I think Onassis said it. Onassis turned around and he said, the only thing you can be sure of is that the sea will never be settled. Therefore, the wise sailor learns to sail in unsettled seas. And in many ways, we as business owners need to accept the fact that through no fault of yours or mine, things have always been uncertain. And through no fault of yours or mine, there are many crises that lie ahead. We need to get expert at dealing with them.
Yeah, and to that point, Pavlo, you talk about the nature of and how to respond to a crisis. It requires action from business owners. You could be either proactive in responding to a crisis or allow yourself to become a casualty of a crisis. Why is being proactive and early to responding to a crisis important? Maybe you can just tackle that for a moment.
So look, you know, when a crisis comes, what does the word crisis mean? Yeah. And it's root meaning. It's root word spelled with a K. So K-R-I-S-I-S. Mm-hmm. It's of Greek origin, and it means a change in the state of health. So from one day to the next, you were well, then you were unwell. And crisis means change in state of health. Sure. And what a crisis does is it changes the status quo for those affected by the crisis. And that change of status quo holds all the value and opportunity for a business owner. And I'll give you two or three examples.
Yeah.
For example, you've been in a very competitive space. You've been unable to get into one or two or three or five or 15 clients that you have been chasing. And they turn on and they say, but Ray, you know, we're well serviced by one of your competitors. There's no need for us to now engage with you. What we can see is what they offer and what you offer is very similar.
Yeah.
Status quo. Very little you can do to get into that client or customer group.
Mm.
The moment there's a crisis, what does it mean? It means that their circumstances and status quo has changed. And if your competitor has not adjusted to meet that new reality of his or her clients, it's a gap for you to step into that place and secure and win those clients. Mm. If you've been trying to make changes in your business and your business is well established and you've been running at a good rate and at a predictable rate, and every time you're trying to introduce a change, your staff members or team turn around and say, Pavlo, why do you want to fix things if it's not broken? Or why do we need to change? Or if they're very polite, what they will say is, yeah, okay, we will adopt this new way of working. And before you know it, 3 months down the line, you're back to the same old habits. When your staff experience in the business that you're in a crisis around the business itself, they themselves are more open to trying and doing new things. And it is a wonderful opportunity, Ray,
yeah,
to start introducing a higher degree of digital capability in the business itself, which will serve you 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the line.
Yeah.
So that change that a crisis brings, that adjusts the status quo, is the single biggest opportunity for an agile, smart, quick-moving, experimental business. And we should always be in that state of condition.
Yeah. Good afternoon. If you've just joined us, all 350 of you, we are talking to Pavlo. He's the author of this book. I'm over here. And please send your comments, your questions through. We need this conversation to be interactive. I'm not going to be a talking head throughout this conversation. But Pavlo, we're human before we're entrepreneurs, and a crisis can be quite crippling. You know, you feel sad, you feel sorry for yourself, you blame yourself, you go through various stages of processing a crisis. In fact, you talk about the Kubler-Ross change curve in your book. But grab a copy of your book. I want you to do a bit of reading for us. On page 37, I want you to read to us about how you, as an entrepreneur, were shocked by the COVID-19 crisis and the various stages you went through. So on page 37, below the Kubler-Ross change curve diagram, when COVID-19 became apparent, and I'll tell you where to start.
Yeah, it's that one there, right?
That's right. I'm there. Too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so when COVID-19 became apparent, I remember the frustration I felt because all the plans that we had for our business for 2020 were going to be fundamentally shattered, and we were going to have to re-strategize and restructure. In December 2019, when I first learned that COVID-19, I found it interesting. It was an intellectual relationship detached from me and my personal circumstances. It was something that was happening far away, and it was my very version of denial.
Yeah.
When speaking to my business owner clients based in Hong Kong, I began to realize that this was real. And Ray, you know what I can tell you? I so clearly remember.
Yeah.
After that phone call, or after that Zoom session, because I was using Zoom some time back, I remember getting into the car to go home. And I pulled up all the windows, and I was shouting at people in the street. Mm-hmm. Any car in front of me, I was shouting at. I was calling people names. I was referring to them as the mistake of their mothers. Terrible, terrible things. But all the windows were up, right? It was only me in the car alone. And I remember the rage I experienced because all the work we had done last year in our business was to set up this year. And I recognized very quickly after that Zoom session, it was a long, devastating Zoom session, that all of the effort last year and all the growth plans and all the motivation and all the direction that we had given our team across four different continents was going to have to be fundamentally reversed and changed. And when you first get that shock, when you first experience that crisis, and you first deny that it's actually happening to you, that process of frustration expresses as either anger or fear. And for me, in the drive home that evening, it was an enormous pity party. I felt so sorry for myself. You have no idea. It was terrible.
Yeah.
And then what happens in the Kubler-Ross curve, and this is why it's so important, is you go crashing down into a well of depression. And the problem with being depressed is that it makes you inactive. And it also orientates your mind, your ears, your eyes, to a place where nothing is ever positively received. You believe that this is happening to you. You believe that you're in the thick of it. You believe that it's personal. And when you're in that deep, dark, negative space, Ray, you can't see any light of Ray. You can't see anything positive.
Yeah.
You lose your energy to act and take control of your life again. And I thought that the Kubler-Ross curve was so important because as a business owner, you build your business much as you would have a loved one in your life that gives you value and meaning. Your business gives you value and meaning. It gives you economy. It gives you purpose. It gives you reason to exist. It allows you to be creative. It allows you to be to contribute to society and the world around you. Sure. And when that was threatened, I immediately had the sense that people would go through that grief life cycle. And until you understand where you are in it, you yourself, until you lead yourself, can't lead others.
Yeah.
And the only way out of a crisis is to lead through action. If you're in a negative, depressed space, any actions you take are going to simply harm the business and harm the relationships that you require in order to get to the other side of it.
Yeah. Where I'm leading with this, Pavlo, is that how did you yank yourself out of that dark space that probably many entrepreneurs are going through right now, you know, into a growth mindset as well? Because it's all well and good to say, you know, I went through that dark space, but, you know, it's the getting yourself out of that dark space and moving and looking forward. And that's the difficult part. So I just wonder, you know, you do have some tips in your book about how to do so.
I do. Yeah. I do. I think I share about 5 or 6 different tools, right? I myself use.
Yeah.
And I've been doing martial arts for years and years and years. And it's amazing. When you step into a ring in a competitive environment, I promise you, Ray, have you ever been hit in the face?
No, and I hope
horrible. I have no idea. It is absolutely terrifying.
Yeah.
That first like shock that you get is horrible. And what happens when you experience shock is you take a gasp of air. And as you breathe into the top of your lungs, it immediately triggers the release of cortisol and adrenaline. And your physical response, driven by the hormones, is to go into a freeze, fight, or flight. And the problem with that is that most decisions you take, especially when other people are affected, and especially when the consequences in the business can be quite devastating, those decisions are very often poor decisions. And I talk about a strategy that I was taught over years and years on how to calm yourself in that environment. I talk about the Upanishads, which are ancient mystical teachings, which I have found so useful to move yourself out of a low energy, depressed state. When you feel that things are against you and you feel that the world is stacking up against you and nothing's moving in your way or direction. And it's ancient, ancient wisdom that's accessible to all of us. I talk about what I learned in the study of the Kabbalah,
yeah,
which is where your energy comes from the future as an entrepreneur. Because the past has happened, the present is what it is, but the future is where you can make things happen differently.
Yeah.
And through those are three of the five or six tools that I share. I found them enormously useful to leave me in a depressed state for at least, Ray, honestly,
yeah,
3 to 5 minutes before I thought, gosh, I need to get out of this mess and I need to get my head right so I can start being in service of my clients, because the phones began to ring.
Yeah. Before we talk about, you know, the concept of seeing your business as an, you call it an asset of value, I want to go to a comment that best describes, you know, how it feels to see your plans, visions of 2020 evaporate because of COVID. But Annie De Beer says, I have a restaurant that was growing very well. The market, however, is students and tourists. I'm struggling to get numbers up. How do I reach new different markets? He or she says using Facebook and Instagram advertising. But let's talk about the concept of building a business, you know, with an asset of value. Can you explain that and perhaps how to get there as well and achieve it?
Yeah. Okay. So, Ray, you know what? If what happens with most of us go into business largely, quite honestly, truthfully, out of necessity.
Yeah.
If you can't get a job in a corporate life, or if you can't get a job in government life, there are very few other opportunities for you. You have to create economy for yourself,
yeah,
and you move into a business. You might buy a franchise or you might start a business. Through that, because in South Africa, we have absolutely zero, none, nada, nix, nothing, startup funding for businesses.
Mm.
You rely extensively on friends, family, and fools, or you... while you're employed, you go and you open up 6 bank accounts and you get 6 credit cards, because when you have a salary, you can do that. And people roll credit cards or they find a way to get going. But those early stages of building a business are nerve-wracking. And as a result of that, you chase every single piece of income that you possibly can. And that makes you and presents your business as being everything to everyone. So you serve anyone, everywhere, anyhow, with anything. It's important. It's important to do that because you need to generate cash flow, and cash flow is like oxygen in the body of the business.
Yeah.
As you progress over time and you start to get a good sense of what your business is about, you need to then mature yourself from being a hustler or an operator or a manager into a CEO. And a CEO needs to be like the captain of a ship. And the captain of a ship has one single job, and that is to know where you are and where you want to sail to, and be sure that you point the ship in that destination, towards the destination, so you get there on time.
Yeah.
And the end goal for all of us in business is going to be one of two paths. It's either going to be a successful sale of the business, which for a business owner is your pension, it's your reward for all the risk you've taken,
yeah,
or it's going to be the closure of a business. And the stats are against us. 94.6% of businesses started globally fail to sell in the end. We spend 10, 20, 30 years building a business, upwards of 70,000 hours.
Yeah.
And when it comes to selling the business, we invest anywhere between 30 to 60 hours. And very often, the business has not been built into a sellable state. An asset of value is an approach that helps you succeed in generating income in the early stages of your existence, but ensures that you build the business into an asset that can be successfully sold and exited, so you can get the reward for all the risk you've had and carried in building the business.
Yeah, I think what best sums it up is chapter four. You talk about understanding your purpose in chapter four, and you remind entrepreneurs that we need to remind ourselves why we do what we do and what are we fighting for, essentially. But a lot of comments about pivoting, Pavlo. Now that COVID is here, lockdown is here, it means that, you know, entrepreneurs are struggling to generate that cash flow you're talking about, or you know, cash flow is becoming strained. Pivoting and finding new opportunities. You write in the book that a lot of entrepreneurs might think that pivoting means completely overhauling your business model and entering a new territory. Is that the case with pivoting and adapting to, I guess, what is the new normal right now?
So Ray, you know what, there's such well-worn words in business. They get used extensively across media. They get used in business schools on top of it. They're written about in books, but technically, there's very little, in my view and experience, understanding behind what they mean. Yeah. Pivoting is one such word. Next level, I want to get to the next level, is another such piece of jargon. Pivoting is mostly understood in terms of West Coast US languaging. And the West Coast in the US is really startup central for the United States, and in many cases, startup central for the world.
Yeah.
Startup central for the world because some of the best and brightest youngsters go there. There are ample skills. There are people with great ambition. There is an enormous amount of money sloshing around. There is a very, very friendly environment for ideas to be brought to market. There's a good understanding of collaboration, or at least that's how it used to be a decade ago. It's no longer like that now. And during that time, everyone thought, well, I'm going to come to market with an idea, and the right way to bring an idea to market is you have a view. You say, I'm going to create a pet food distribution business online.
Yeah.
You start the business, you build out the business, and to the extent that you have success, you continue. To the extent that you don't, you pivot. And you realize actually that nappies online is a far better business to build than dog food online. And effectively, it means you move into a completely different sector and industry.
Yeah.
And you move in the direction of where the money is coming in. Okay. Absolutely crucial for the first 2, 3, 4 years of your business. But pivoting in the sense of a business that's established has to be done differently. I saw people in sheer panic or out of sheer opportunity involved in food services all of a sudden start manufacturing and distributing hand sanitizer.
Oh, wow.
I saw businesses that were making and servicing pumps in the mines all of a sudden start sewing and stitching masks.
That's quite a leap, right?
Yeah. And when I spoke to the business owners and I said, what are you doing?
Sure.
They said, Pavlo, we've got to move in the direction of the money. That's what pivoting is. Mm. And I said, no, when you're established, and Ray, I give a very, very good structure around how you pivot an established business in the book.
Yeah.
I talk to understanding your value stack. And every one of us, even if you've been in the restaurant industry, even if you have serviced tourists, every one of us has accumulated value over time. And the value is a skill set. It's relationships based on your reputation.
Yeah.
It's the knowledge of a sector or an industry. It's understanding where the risk and opportunity in that sector lies. It's collaborations that you can pull together within the industry and sector. And a pivot should always be worked off the back of your value stack. If it means in pivoting that you're going to go into a completely different sector, one that you have no knowledge of, one where you can't read the risk, you don't understand the supply chain, you don't understand the value chain, you don't understand how things work, you don't know who your competitors will be. You've got a sense of the product, but you don't really know the challenges around making the product or distributing the product or servicing people who buy the product. That kind of pivot where you move away from your area of knowledge and understanding, history and value, into virgin territory,
yeah,
where as a 15-year-old business, you're suddenly a one-day-old business. I think that as a pivot in the midst of a crisis is a fear flight. It's a flight, freeze, fight response. It's not a good decision to make because you never carry any of your value with you.
I mean, here's an example from Billion. He or she says, my husband and I launched a small tourism business in August 2019 aimed at the international market. When domestic tourism opened up, we changed our pricing to attract locals and have been pleased with the results. It's still not sustainable though. And I hear what Pavlo is saying about growth, but I'm seeing this COVID-19, post-COVID-19 time as a good time to coast and to experiment and to refine our product rather than focusing on growth. Am I wrong in doing this?
No, absolutely not. Because here's the thing. So pre-lockdown, the world was fairly well known. As South Africans, we had our challenges, their ongoing challenges, whether it be shoddy politics that doesn't support the economy, or whether it be Eskom, or whatever the case might be. But for us, that was normal. For us, that was normal. What now happened is that the status quo has changed. And when this crisis comes and goes, which it will, Ray, in the next year or so, we're going to find ourselves in an environment that is changed in three different ways. The first way is that you'll be left with anywhere between 30 to 70% of your former competitors. Many businesses have not had the fire in the belly or ability to actually survive so far. A number of others will close down in the next year, and you're going to find yourself in a far less competitive environment.
Yeah.
Of those that are there, 10% of them would have reset and readjusted to be thriving and relevant. And the other 90% are going to be late starters coming back into the economy. And then the third factor is this. When a crisis hits and you're in the red zone, in other words, you're a high-risk business, there's only one game in town, and that is preserve capital. Because it's a capital that will allow you a year from now to restart the business again. And if you restart the business in the same sector and industry you were in, and you have over the period of the year maintained those relationships, I speak about that extensively in the book, you maintain relationships with a view to grow off the relationships as opposed to maintaining contact with the view to transact in the midst of an environment where you can't, and through that you erode your capital. It is about last man or woman standing if you're in the red zone of the economy. So that strategy deployed by that organization is spot on. You're not here to make money over the next year. You're here to be in play for when the economy starts to return to some form of normality.
When you said earlier that about 94% of businesses cannot be sold, you know, Colin Skeleton says, what determines that a business has value and worth buying? What needs to be in place for a business to have a sellable value?
Well, there are a couple of things. If you think about, put yourself in the shoes of a buyer. So the first thing I always look for when I buy businesses on behalf of my clients is I turn on and say, okay, Ray, what makes your business special? Now, if you turn around and say to me, oh, no, you know, it's my product. My product is special. What I do know for a fact is that products have no competitive advantage. Because if I'm in a competitive market and I've got a great product, tomorrow my competitors will have equally good products. So there's no sustainable advantage in having the best product. Next. Well, Ray, you know what? We have the best price.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The same condition applies. If my price is good and I'm getting market access through my price, my competitors are going to respond and have an equally good price, if not better price. The third thing people said to me, no, Ray, it's my service. You know, we've got really good relationships and we've got personal service. And then what I do is I look to see where the cause of the service is, where the seed of that service is. And if I can see it's you who is responsible for the good service your clients have, and I'm buying your business, it means that I'm buying a business that's been built on the back of your relationships with your clients. And when I buy the business today and you leave tomorrow, what am I left with? So the first question you always have to answer is, what makes my business special? And if the answer is not, I know who my clients are, I know that I exist to solve problems for them, I know what problems they have and what the cost of the problem they have is, and I know that I can solve that problem consistently and reliably for them, so that my business becomes a lived brand in the lives of my customers, then nothing else that you have makes your business special. Then the buyer says, okay, so I can see, Ray, what makes your business special, and I can see that you have brand relevance in the lives of well-defined groups of customers who really love you, and they love you and they support you consistently because you solve problems. My next question is, okay, how far into the future can the business continue for? Because if you leave tomorrow, how will the business continue? And you then need to be able to answer that question by at least stating, and I write about this extensively in the book.
Yeah.
Well, Ray, what will happen when I leave is I have built business systems, activities in a sequence that can be measured and taught to make sure that the brand is kept alive. So whether I'm there or not, my team knows exactly what to do, how to do it. They do it predictably, they do it consistently. And that means whether I'm there or not, the business will be able to continue into the future. Yeah. Those are two fundamental questions that every buyer will ask. They're two fundamental questions that every funder will ask. And so far, the stats show that 94.6% of businesses, good businesses that have made money for the business owners, when it comes to answering those questions, don't have an answer.
Sure. Yeah, you're right. I mean, you write about it in your book. You know, what makes a business special is not the individual or personalities behind the business. I think you talk about, a business should be beyond the individual behind it, that is. But there's a question that came in before we started with the webinar, Pavlo. This person asked, what do you consider to be the most important leadership trait post-COVID-19 if a business is to move to a growth phase? So we're talking about the individual, the entrepreneur, what leadership qualities should they have?
So I think the most important, there are quite a few different leadership traits, right? You know, if you think of what the root word behind leadership means two things. There are two Latin words that derive the word leader. And the Latin words are ledere and leader. Ledere means from the front. Mm. One foot in front of the next, from the front. In a crisis, you lead from the front. You lead and you fight the battle at the front line of the battle, not from the tent up on the hill. Leader means careful consideration consolidated into one action. So it's where you look at a situation, you think of it in terms of dark and light, left and right. You consider what you could do, what you could not do. You consider your options. And then you take a view and you act on that view, knowing full well that you will only find your truth in action. And that takes an enormous amount of self-confidence, but more importantly, it takes an enormous amount of self-control. It means that you need to manage yourself through that Elizabeth Kubler-Ross curve. You always need to be on the positive side of it, not in the negative side of depression on it. You need to be able to communicate very openly with your team. You need to be able to have the confidence to say, I don't know if this is going to work. It's the best decision we can take now. Let's act on it and then double down on what does work and what doesn't work. In the midst of a crisis, when you're right at that battlefront, that's the mindset that you need and the behavior you need in order to lead. The strategy that I share in the book which is fundamentally premised on resetting to be relevant, rebuilding to create the systems, and then eventually reigniting to make up for the lost growth, is the strategy that should sit behind that leadership skill and capability.
Yeah. I mean, someone wants to steal your ideas, Pavlo. I'm not sure if you're willing to share them publicly.
I will share everything publicly.
Someone wants to know which business opportunities are there currently in this market, and in an environment of crisis, you know, where to go in terms of opportunities.
Now you see that is this kind of pivot mindset.
Sure.
If you're simply going to chase opportunity for the money, I think that you're going to fail horribly. The best opportunity lies in the following place. You need to do something you love and believe in. If you don't do something you love and believe in, if you don't do something that you can't develop a passion for, whether it be the clients or customers you serve, or whether it be the product or service that you build, you will fail in business. And you will fail for the simple reason that the ideas you have are going to be rejected so many times that if you're not driven with a full tank of passion, you will run out of steam. You will not survive the first year, 2-3 years. An idea that you build a business to make money needs to be a consequence of you having built a business to be in service of customers and clients. You need to love and matter to your customers and clients, and you need to do so with the product. I want to share a personal story.
Please.
All right.
At school, I was a C, B math kid. I just could not crack math. Really, it just had no interest. I had no interest. It had no value for me. I did science, averaged a C the whole way through. And then when I left school, and I was very, very fortunate to be able to put myself through university, I did maths for 3 years, math 1, 2, and 3, and I did physics 1 and 2. And all those years, I got distinctions. And I learned something valuable from that. And that is that when you set your mind to do something, and you can start to see how it's of interest to you, because at university it was applied maths, and at university physics was applied the whole time, and I could see its relevance in the world, I could see its relevance in how things were made, I could see its relevance in my own life.
Sure.
And the more attention I paid to it, because I was interested in it, the better I got at it, and the better I got at it, the more attention I paid to it. And the more attention I paid to it, the better I got at it. And the better I got at it, the more I succeeded. And the more I succeeded, the more time I spent on it.
Yeah.
That is where the opportunity lies in a COVID or non-COVID economy. It's irrelevant.
Yeah.
Because if you're going to change what you do every time a crisis arrives, you're going to fall into the category of what I refer to as a serial entrepreneur. And that is someone who hustles left, right, and center. And 5, 10, 15 years down the line, you might have made some money, but you built nothing behind you. And you have no momentum to ever create a wealth-creating asset, an opportunity to get yourself and your family to the next level.
Yeah, or something sustainable, in fact. But
something sustainable, yeah.
I realize we only have 10 minutes, and this discussion, we stuck on chapter 4, Pavlo. We need to move on to the other aspects of the book. But before we do move on, can you please address Constance Gumeda's question about what are the chances of getting investors as we face challenges of being unable to get loans that were promised by the government? So basically getting support from investors in this.
Okay. You know what, Ray, stop there immediately. Because let me tell you why.
Mm.
Constance, here's the reality.
Mm.
I promise you, nobody cares about you. A politician will say what a politician needs to say to get a vote today. They do not care about you. A big corporate entity will say to you, as a small business supplier, what they need to say to you today, but there's very little that lies behind it. The point that I'm trying to make here is if you have to build a business with funding when there is no funding available, because there is none available, then you're finding unconsciously an excuse to not succeed. Because there's always a way to start generating your own funding. When I look at Auric, the way that I built Auric in the beginning is I had to be a consultant. I had to hustle and find a client. I had to then share advice. And I used to get paid these crappy amounts of money. But I saved and saved and saved. And at the same time, I learned to understand where to find more and more and more clients. Because I understood all the while the questions they were asking. And eventually over time, I developed a method to help clients asking for help more efficiently. And eventually over time, I'd saved enough money to employ a person who I could teach on the method that I was using so I could do more. Now, if I had been given the privilege of R1 million to start the business, it would have made my life a hell of a lot easier in the beginning. But I'll tell you something, Auric would never be what it is today. And it works across 5 countries globally. Those early years of absolute sweat and stress built the fundamental muscle and character that now sits in my knowledge around how to work with businesses and how we ourselves built Auric. They were valuable beyond anything you can imagine.
Yeah. It's kind of frustrating though, Pavlo, I must say, because, you know, in every key government policy document drafted, you know, small businesses are mentioned as, you know, a vector of job creation in South Africa. You even have a ministry, in fact, for small businesses. And
It's all talk. There's no walk behind it at all. There's no walk behind it at all. And here's my argument.
Yeah.
And in the book, I talk about it. Mm. You need to work with the absolute truths. So absolute truths. You were born. I promise you, you were born. There's no question about that. Another absolute truth is you will die one day. No question about it. Here's an absolute truth. There's only one thing, and here's a challenge to everyone on this webinar. What is the one thing that you have 100% control over? Write it down on a piece of paper. The one thing you have 100% control over. And that is your attitude. You can choose your attitude. And the reason that's so important is because the way you choose to look at something, the way you choose to believe a politician or believe the bank or believe a customer or believe a staff member, the way you choose to believe will lead to how you behave. And how you behave will give you the result of your business, your relationship, your life. And if it's not working, because you have 100% control over your attitude, you need to choose a different attitude. And that's why getting different perspectives, especially through reading, especially through conversation, is important. Because if you find the attitude that then eventually works for you, it's sorted, you've won. You're ahead of the pack, I promise you.
So you're pointing the finger at us, Pavlo, basically. Noel Ramassar, and I hope I'm pronouncing your surname right. I'm sorry if I'm not. He says, Pavlo, impressed that you can write and publish a book in 6 months. How do you do this? Well, he's an overachiever, basically. So I've answered that.
It's, when you write on something that you believe in, when you write from direct experience, not theory, and when you write with a really good publisher behind you, who whips you daily to meet milestones, and you're prepared to do a 16-hour day in the middle of a crisis, eventually a book emerges.
Wow, Pavlo. I want to spend the last 5 minutes talking about the future and Pavlo and other chapters in the book, especially about, you know, managing cash flow and negotiating as well. The reality is other countries are facing a second wave of infections, such as the UK and France. And with that comes other lockdown restrictions on public life. So South Africa, we might go through that in the next few months. So there is that threat looming. So between now and whenever that, you know, possibility, you know, lands in South Africa, you know, how do entrepreneurs manage cash flow and prepare for that eventuality as well?
So in the book, there's a technique that I use, Ray, called the onion peeler. And, you know, I really was troubled about calling it the onion peeler because it makes me sound not serious and it doesn't make me sound like a million-dollar consultant because I never gave it some very deep, intellectual, complicated terminology with a fancy diagram, you know, done by someone who is a PowerPoint rock star. But the reality is that that onion peeler method, where you learn to look at your business as one would look at an onion, with the central inner valuable core where the flavor lies, a middle layer where you've got some burn to join with the sweet inside flavor, and the skin on the outer layer. That method of understanding what really, truly, truly matters to your business's ability to do what it does, with the view that you could, should you choose to, or should you have to, discard everything else in the business so that you find yourself on the other side of a crisis with the ability to build again, as opposed to the other side of the crisis with nothing left. That approach, that method, and that's why I called it the onion peeler, the simplicity of it is available and accessible to every human being. It's not that hard to do if you just have a structure, a method to look at your business differently. And I would implore anyone to adopt that as a framework to make a decision over the next year, because we're here in the space for at least another year.
Sure. Can we leave on a high note, Pavlo? Please.
Here's the high note. You will rue the day if you have not capitalized on this crisis. Mm. By that, what I mean is the change in status quo that's been experienced by everyone, everywhere, right across the environment. If you've not found a way to be relevant within that, your ability, in other words, to reset, your ability to find yourself 6 months from now, making up for all the lost revenues, will be lost. You must act now. It's not too late. It's not too late to change what you do, make the tweaks, make the adjustments, stay true to your customers and clients, stay true to your sector and industry, and you will be one of the survivors. And those survivors are going to make up for massive, massive lost revenues in a massive, massive way. So act now. It's in your control.
Well, here's the book. It's available at bookstores. Someone asked us, is it available on audiobook, Pablo?
No. Can I be honest with you? You know, Sweat Scale Sell, my first book, if I may, right? That Sweat Scale Sell, that talks about building an asset of value. That's available on audio. Reset, Rebuild, Reignite is the kind of book, with respect, and you've read it, where I think you're going to need post-it notes and a pad.
Yeah.
I've made it very, very practical, because in the midst of a crisis, the last thing you want is to try and interpret what the strategy is. You want a strategy that's tried and tested, one that works, and one that will get you to the other side of the crisis safely, and in fact, positively thriving in the midst of that crisis. So there are a couple of chapters over there where I get very, very practical. You've got to do A, B, C in this order, in the sequence, for the following reasons. And that doesn't lend itself well, in my view, to an audiobook.
Yeah.
Maybe perhaps next year, when there is a bit of time, we'll reduce it to an audiobook. But right now, I think it's a book best read either digitally or physically.
Yeah. Gonna have to leave it there. Thank you so much, everybody. Pavlo, pick up the book. It's just not for entrepreneurs, I think. But Pavlo, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate the time, Ray. And thank you to everyone who joined us.
Absolutely. Thank you to everybody. Take care. Cheers.